Welcome viewers. Today we are going to do chapter 2, which is methods of inquiry in psychology. We'll be covering 5 topics today. First, goals of psychological inquiry, steps of psychological inquiry, nature of data collection, alternate paradigms of research, and the first method, which is observation. Now, this chapter carries 9 marks according to the final term. The previous chapter we had done was for 8 marks. Let's start with the first topic, goals of psychological inquiry. Now, let's understand what is inquiry first. Inquiry basically means any kind of investigation that you do, any kind of research that you do, any problem that you study in a scientific manner. So, goals here that we have are description, prediction, explanation, control, and application. Let's take up a problem. A researcher wants to study the impact of study time on the performance of a child. So, for this, the researcher has to give and identify the basic meaning of study time and performance, that is description. The researcher is going to forecast, that is predict, what is the impact of study time on the performance. Third is explanation, that is causal factors. The researcher here is going to understand what is the factor which is going to lead to better study time and therefore better performance. It could be better concentration, it could be interest of the child. So, all these factors are going to result in better performance. Control is a tool in the hands of the researcher. This is basically to modify and manipulate whatever research or whatever variables the researcher is trying to identify and highlight. That is the control. So, any kind of modification that the researcher makes in the design of the experiment, that is the control in the hands of the researcher. Then we have application. Once the research conclusion is drawn, after the various methods of data collection, methods have been used, data has been collected, research conclusion has been drawn, then obviously it is ready and fit for being applied to the real life setting. That's the goals of psychological inquiry. Let's move on to the second topic, steps of research. First is conceptualizing the problem, which is exactly the same as description. We are trying, as a researcher, we are trying to identify what are we trying to study, describe it, because our definition, our criteria of highlighting it will be different from the other person understanding it. Then we have data collection. Once we have conceptualized the problem in a scientific manner, in a manner which is having a step-by-step description, then we try and collect the data through the use of sample and through the use of methods of data collection. So, once data is collected, we move on to the third step, which is drawing conclusion, basically trying to identify the basic outcome of the research, that is drawing conclusions. And once research conclusions are drawn out of the data, then that is revised. In case there's any change, that is revised. So, this is a step-by-step procedure that we have conducting data research. Now, we also have here alternate paradigms of research. This topic basically means two things. When we talk about psychology as a science, we understand the fact that it is a very objective branch. Like all the sciences, it is trying to collect the data through experimentation, through a step-by-step procedure. But at the same time, do you think it is possible to understand what happens to tsunami victims through a scientific experimentation? Can we understand their thoughts and feelings through the method of experimentation? We get them to the laboratory and do an experiment on them. Or in the other instance, if we want to study about sleep for a behavior, can we deprive participants out of sleep for 2 days and then study them? All these concerns, therefore, we have subjective methods also, which is very different from the objective scientific method. So, we cannot study everything scientifically because we are studying and dealing with human beings. We are not dealing with objects like science. Therefore, we need to respect their privacy, their thoughts and feelings also. We need to respect their experience. This is where we have both the methodologies, scientific as well as subjective. Let's move on to the next topic, which is nature of data. Now, we have 5 kinds of data here. Let's understand what is data first. Data basically means information. So, information we have in 5 different regards. We have the physical information. So, physical information basically refers to the physical aspects of a person we are studying. It could be measuring the blood pressure of a person. This is physiological as we call it. It could be measuring the heart rate of a person. It could be measuring the height and weight of the person. It could be measuring the tiredness level of a person. All of this is the bodily relation, physiological. Second, we have the demographic data. Demographic basically means personal information of a person. So it could also mean the name of the person, the age, the gender, the socioeconomic status. All these aspects could be the demographic data. It could be the religion, the caste as well. Then we have the third kind, which is the surrounding, the environmental data that we have. This data basically studies geographical location. So it talks about where the person is residing, what kind of houses are there, what kind of neighborhood, what kind of transportation, all these factors. Next one is the psychological data. Now, psychological data basically talks about your psychological variables. Everybody is different because of certain aspects, because of certain components. These components can be your intelligence, which make you different from the other person. This aspect could be creativity, it could be personality. These are all variables in psychology that we try and study. Now, we have the major topic of the chapter, which is some important methods in psychology. Now, these are methods which are not just exclusive to psychology. We also have certain methods which are unique to psychology. So, we'll be covering both the methods. First, we have the observational method that we are going to do today. Let's look at the observational method. Now, let me ask you this question. If we talk about general observation, you are observing me, but how is this observation different from a scientific observation? That is what we have to understand. I am sitting and observing two children playing. How is that observation different from the scientific observation? That is the whole question here. Let's read the definition. Observation is a powerful tool of psychological inquiry. It's an effective way of describing human behavior. A scientific observation differs from day-to-day observation in three respects. Normally, because we say it is scientific, obviously it's going to have three different steps. Here we have three steps. First is selection, recording is the second one, and analysis of the data. Now, obviously, if I have to observe somebody scientifically, I need to know what to observe. I need to differentiate relevant behaviors from irrelevant behaviors. I need to have a criteria for identifying what is important behavior from my research point of view. So that is what is a selection process. Second is recording. If I am selecting a particular behavior, I need to know which settings I am recording that particular behavior in. How am I doing the recording? How am I trying to identify how many times the behavior has occurred, in which settings the behavior has occurred? So that is the process of recording, where we could do in tally marks. We can make tally marks and record the number of times, or we can do a video recording or a photograph. We can record through that. We'll have a data. Last step is analysis. Obviously, when we have the recording done, we will have to analyze that particular data. We knew what we were studying, we recorded it, and now we want to analyze that particular data. That is the observation method. We have two kinds of observation method. First is naturalistic versus controlled. Second is non-participant versus participant observation. Now, naturalistic basically means in the real setting that the person is being observed. For you, the setting will be school. For the teacher teaching you, also the setting will be school. So, in the classroom itself, when a supervisor comes to observe your class, that is a naturalistic setting. So, there will be lots of advantages that in the real setting, there will be no artificiality. You will be behaving in a way as you are. There will be no change in your behavior because you are, suppose there is a one-way mirror through which you are being observed. That is also naturalistic because the person doesn't know that there's any observation going on. The person is going to behave normally. Controlled will be in the controlled setting, basically it is under the control of the researcher who is trying to do the research. So the researcher will determine factors, the researcher will tell you, the researcher will guide you. So your behavior will basically depend on what inputs you are being given. So conditions will be changed, manipulations will be done, all of that. Suppose a laboratory setting and observation is being made, and that is where it's a controlled setting because you are behaving and you're getting very conscious also that I have to behave according to what the researcher expects me to do. Second kind of observation is non-participant versus participant. Participant refers to when a person becomes a part of a culture and goes to observe that culture. A person working in a mall is trying to understand the setup of the mall. That is participant versus non-participant observation. We have the next one, which is advantages and the disadvantages of the observational method. Obviously, when we talk about observation, it's a very direct method. We are trying to study behavior in the natural setting. That's the most important advantage of observation method. And obviously, second point, it can be generalized to any setting that you want because we are doing a natural setup. Then we have it as a scientific method that we know observation we are using as a scientific method. And of course, it's having a convenience of all the other methods also. Let's look at the disadvantages now. It is susceptible to observer's bias. Now, one major drawback about observation method here is a lot of training is required to groom the person as to what to observe, how to observe, when to observe. So that is where my own personal bias will definitely come in because I am not a machine. I am a human being doing a research. So when I'm doing a research, my own likes, thoughts, dislikes, all of that will also come in picture. That adds to its subjectivity. It is very labor intensive because a lot of money is involved, a lot of time is involved, a lot of training is involved. It obviously has all these disadvantages. To summarize what we have done today, we started with the meaning of psychological inquiry. So every inquiry in psychology follows a certain method. It follows a problem that we start with. We follow the method of data collection. Now, when we talk about research here, in summarization, when we talk about research, we are basically trying to understand the problem that we take in goals as well as in steps. The problem is decided, understood, identified, and then we move on to the method of data collection. Now, that is happening with the design that we frame as a researcher, the design of the experiment, the design of the observation. Every researcher follows this design so that next person, whoever does it, does this replicability or verifiability of research. So, this is a very standard way of doing research, that a particular design is formulated. Steps are identified, definitions are given, the way of data collection is given, the sample is selected. All these steps are followed in the same way so that whoever does it the next, that is the advantage of scientific process of research. There's one term also which needs to be summarized, which is hypothesis. Now, hypothesis in a science like it is always used is basically talking about assumptions. It's a tentative assumption that we talked about in the forecast also, the same goals. So, goals had the same aspects which are covered in steps as well. Let's relate the two in summarization. Goals had description, it had prediction, it had control, it had application. Similarly, steps had starting with the problem. So, problem is related to the description because we are describing the same aspects in a research, highlighting it, identifying it so that we can do a research because we need to know what topic are we researching on. These are the two topics related. Second step which is related in the two is when we, after describing the details of what we are studying, we use certain methods of data collection. So, data collection methods can be any in number. It can be qualitative method, it can be quantitative method. Qualitative could include any kind of story, any kind of photograph, any kind of content that you study to analyze that. Quantitative methods will definitely have others like which are purely scientific and rigidly being followed. Then we, after that, we have conclusion which are drawn from the research and then we revise those research conclusions either in a subjective manner or in an objective manner. And of course, we have five different kinds of data collection methods that we followed. That's about today's topic. Thank you.